Welcome back. You're listening to Motivation Minute, where we unravel the timeless truths in that stack of books you've been wanting to read so that you don't have to. And I'm Spencer Harrow. I'm a software engineer from Baltimore, joined again by Jariah Miller from Lee, Montana.
What's up, Spencer?
Hey, it's going well. And this week, it's a privilege to have an author on with us of the book, It Starts With You, Turn Your Goals Into Success. And so welcome to the show, Fred Stuvik.
Spencer and Jariah, thank you for having me on. It's a pleasure. It's an honor as well.
It's very fun to have you. Yeah, and you found us through the survey that we have out, which is really cool. Mm-hmm. I was surprised to see an author write the survey, and that was very fun to see.
Yeah, it was serendipitous, I guess you would say. I just Googled top 20 podcasts, and your link came up. So I sent you a message, and you responded. So I guess that reaffirms the fact that you are in the top 20 since I contacted you. You got back right
away. That is really cool. You say serendipitous. That rolls right into my first thought I wanted to bring up, which was the point of the book is that positive mindsets aren't achieved serendipitously.
Correct.
It's actually a very intentional act that you build a positive outlook for yourself. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, how you're inspired to write the book and kind of the main point from the positive mindset angle?
Yes. Well, when I sold my company,
which you were in the medical industry, right?
Medical services company. My last position or last company, and I sold it. And I was trying to sort out what to do. And while I was doing that, I'd given a few talks to mostly in state, a couple, in the eastern part of the United States, and almost without exception, everybody would come up to me and say, "Where can I buy your book?" And I said, "Well, I haven't written one." And, you know, I was encouraged to write a book, and by several people, my wife as well. I try to listen to her as much as, it makes for healthy relationships. So I decided to write a book. But, you know, one of the things I wanted to do was to write something a little bit different, something that would, you've probably heard the saying, you have to believe in yourself. Okay.
Yeah. Or a little bit cliche.
Where you can be successful. But have you ever seen anybody tell you or lay out to you exactly what it is you have to do?
Because the roadmap.
It's a full range of issues, Spencer. Success isn't one thing that you do, it's a number of things. And the strength of these issues all converge to help you become successful. By the same token, the absence will affect you as well. So, this book, which many people refer to as a life coach in print, is something that I believe is unique and novel in terms of it comprehensively, but specifically addresses three things: what is important, why it's important, and how you do something about it. And I put it together in such a manner that each chapter builds on the other, and then you can also use it later on as a reference manual. And you might notice in the book, I like lists, and I like the numbers 3, 5, and 10. So everything,
those are good numbers.
5 or 10. And so if you notice that everything in it, are these the three things you need to do? These are the five things, or these?
Yeah, I really liked how you put the summaries at the end of the chapters. Small lists of simple to the point of principles.
Easy to remember.
And just in talking about the book, I was very surprised or impressed at how well-rounded and comprehensive the book is. Like you said, it's not just one thing. You covered so many different aspects in this book, everything from people skills, communication, leadership, and then believing in yourself, confidence. And then you talked about planning, about practical tips, about getting mentors. Like, there was just so many things that just was so, it's not like most books where it's just one kind of point, but your book is like very well rounded, and it comes from your just incredible life experience, because you wrote that you have, or you worked in different fields, and you have an interesting background from the military and sports and training, education, and also in, you started a company. So it's really an honor to have you on the show. And talk a little bit about more about your a little bit of your history.
Yep. Well, I was born in West Virginia, grew up in southwestern Pennsylvania, and in southwestern Pennsylvania, we had four seasons. We had football, basketball, track, and baseball, and I participated in all four seasons. And as I was getting into my formative years, which, you know, I mean, my formative years, I was a teenager. I mean, we had a large family with seven in a family and a school teacher's salary from, you know, my father. You know, it became apparent to me that if I wanted to go to college, I would have to get a scholarship. So that was one of my goals, was to get a scholarship. So I was fortunate to have been recruited by a number of schools, primarily for football, and decided to go to the Naval Academy. After I played,
that's cool.
I played football there. I lettered 3 years as quarterback. I did graduate, I might add. After that, I was commissioned. I served for 5 years, got out of the service, and then I went into the business world, where I was both in the public and private sector. I was involved in an IPO, started companies up, sold companies. And after I sold my last company, I decided to write a book. And getting to Jiraiya's point, I think one of the things that's unique about the book, and I'm not trying to sound, you know, braggadocious, but I do have a skill set that I don't think you've had anybody on your podcast that has the range of experience that I've had in both the sports, the military, and the business, both in the public and the private sector. Been through the IPO, bought companies, sold companies, et cetera. So the point I'm getting at, the things that I'm talking about have been, I've used them. They've been tested and proven in a range of environments. This isn't theoretical. I didn't get a PhD at some school and then decide to write a book and then go get on the lecture circuit. It was quite the other way around. Yeah, so
you've lived it out.
So part of the way you probably pulled this off is the mindset you've had, which is a big thing you point out in the book, that mindset is critical, and keeping a positive mindset. But one thing was about how when you face an obstacle, you think, like the thing that we usually think is, I don't know what to do, but the better thing to think is, I'll figure this out. Mm-hmm. And you're talking about like a very wide range of experience, because you have the public and private sectors, you have the military, you've owned companies. So with that wide breadth of experience, having that mindset that I'll figure this out, did that make a big difference versus, you know, just kind of like going with the wind?
Yeah. I mean, I use the term mindset a lot in the book, because the first thing that you have to do, Spencer and Dry, you have to get your mind right, especially your subconscious. It tells you what to do. And particularly when you're under stress, that's your default mode. And the mind can be conditioned just like any other muscle in the body. If you train and condition your mind, your prospects for success and fulfillment are increased exponentially.
Actually, I was just seeing this week, that mindset's important, because at work, I had to tackle this problem that no one else is working on, that involves a piece of software that doesn't have much documentation about it and nobody really uses, but I had to come up with a better way to run it. And it's a little bit hacky the way I had to solve the problem, because there's just not people that have done this very often. But I could have approached it thinking, you know, I don't know what to do, I'm just going to let it happen and see what happens. Well, I went at the approach of, I'll figure this out, like you're talking in the book. And it's interesting, because when you take that mindset, everything you're looking at changes. So I went online and I start looking at documentation and I read it in a new way. And I realized, oh, there's more information about this software than I realized there was because of the mindset shift.
Yep. And, you know, that's, I mean, you have to dive deep. I mean, you're willing to take on a challenge. The easiest thing is to say, I can't do this. Well, you know, attitude is altitude, because if you have that, if you have that attitude, you can go higher. Now, if you try something, okay, let's say it didn't work out. Will you call that a failure? Well, maybe, maybe not. But what's worse than failing? Never trying and not knowing.
Trying.
Okay.
So right.
If you try and you succeed, that's great. And if you try and you didn't succeed, well, that's okay too, because that's a learning experience.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's one step closer.
Yeah, it's good either way. And life isn't about having all the answers. Oftentimes, it's about knowing where to look, who to ask to find the answers. And you found that out with your question on the software, right?
Right.
Yeah. It's like one of those things where we don't know what we don't know. And if we don't have the mindset of I can figure this out, or you talk about belief in yourself, and that's, and you said that's yeah. where it starts. So if, that's so important, because if we don't have that to start with, then we won't even believe it's possible, so we won't even go looking for new information.
And something that personal belief does is it gives you, the book was talking about personal authority
yeah.
versus positional authority.
Yep.
And that's interesting, because so it's always better to have personal authority than positional, because
you can take personal authority with you, not
right. It's anywhere.
Yeah.
Positional, you're waiting for other people to shove it on you.
Yep.
But you have 100% control
yep.
when it's personal authority. And that's all about the mindset, the confidence, the belief you have in yourself.
Hmm. And that's a, you know, that's a good point. I want to back up to something Shirai said about, you know, belief. I mean, and there's, it's not by coincidence that that is the first chapter in the book.
Yeah.
Believe, because if you don't believe in yourself, and that's really kind of a twofold issues. If you don't believe in yourself, how do you expect other people to firmly and staunchly believe in you?
Huh.
And then the other thing is, you have to believe in what you're doing. You have to be, you know, it has to be a good fit, which I bring up in the book, but you have to believe in what you're doing, and it has to be a good fit, and you have to be skilled. You have to train, you have to be dedicated. And if you do those things, it's going to come together. But if you're doing something because your value system is at odds with each other, that's going to be a problem. Now, what does that mean? You have intrinsic and extrinsic. Let's say, for example, mm-hmm. you want to make a lot of money. You decide you want to go into sales. Well, maybe you should be a software engineer. It has to be a good fit. So if you're going yeah. into something just to make money, and it's not a good fit in terms of what yeah. you find satisfying and what you believe in, when things get tough and when things get tight, it's going to come back around and haunt you. And eventually it's going to bite you on the butt. It'll hurt you.
So it's kind of like a balance between the mental and then the physical or the practical. So it's like you have to have the faith that you can figure it out and learn and believe in yourself. But then you also practically have to find a career that's a good fit for you or with your unique personality, skills, and something that,
yeah.
that, and something that you believe in long term. And like you said, not something that's a quick money making opportunity. We talked about this in the last episode of it's about the long term and how something that fits. So it's like that balance that you talk
yeah,
about.
Yeah. On the balance idea, like it's like the how of how you train, the what of how you train, the how much you train, that all matters, and how you balance that out.
It does because, I mean, if you look at success and you look at the people that are successful, the emotional quotient is much more important. It's your ability to relate to people, to empathize with people, to communicate with them, to understand them. It's your ability to handle adversity, to be resilient, okay, and to keep your composure in times of stress and all those things put together. Those are the hallmarks of someone that's going to be successful.
Interesting. So do you think you'd find someone who's got a high EQ, but or would it be better to have someone with a high EQ or a high EQ and a high IQ? Like, because personal skills, the soft skills
yeah.
are actually really important, because a lot of people argue you can teach anyone a job if they have the soft skills and the ability to learn.
Usually, I mean, there's a balance there. I mean, usually one's more than the other. I mean, if you had somebody yeah. who was 100% maxed out on their EQ and 100% maxed out on
you got the dream person right there.
I think then Marvel should probably contact him. Be a superhero or something like that. But
yeah, they're probably not available.
Yeah, but between the two, I would pick emotional quotient, and I actually referred to that in my book. There was one chapter where we had a very technical position that was open in the company. And extremely technical, working with collaborative R&D teams around the world, working with PhD scientists, etc. And there were five or six people that applied for the job. Now, the five out of the six had PhDs. The sixth guy was a writer. He had no technical background. But boy, could he communicate. He had an excellent personality. And I chose the writer. Now, the whole place went crazy. They said, Fred, why are you doing that?
I bet.
I said, I'll tell you why. It's going to be easier for him to learn the technology that it is for the PhDs or for the technical people to learn to work with the people and collaborate and communicate.
It's something that you, because I think, well, talking about literal IQ, you can't really control your, you know, your intelligence or what, where you were born with, but you can, like you were saying earlier, these things that we can control, like our people skills, we can grow them, and, you know, just personal skills that we can grow, which has to do with EQ, right? And mm-hmm. so it puts the responsibility on ourselves, right? To where we have the power to change or to get better, and it's not just set in stone with however we were born, right?
Yep. And you know, and the emotional quotient also refers to the ability. It's your self-awareness, but it's your self-control. Because if you can't control your emotions and yourself, you're going to have a hard time, you know, in relationships and with companies, because that means you don't have discipline, which means that's going to result in making bad decisions and developing bad habits. And that is not a good formula.
Wow. So it's so important to know your strengths and weaknesses when working with other people. You talked about a little bit about how important it is for communication and how important it is to confront issues in conflicts and relationships. Is that important to not just let things, you know, build up inside, but to communicate, right?
Yeah. Yes. And you know, and you need to lay things out, but it needs to be done in such a manner that it's direct, but it's also done in a professional and consequent manner. It's like criticism. There's a difference between constructive criticism and negative criticism. It needs to be constructive, and you need to say it in the right way. I mean, for example, have you ever seen the movie Kingdom of Heaven?
Yes, I have.
Okay, remember whenever Liam Neeson protected Orlando Bloom, whenever they came and said, hand him over to us?
I believe so, yeah.
And he wouldn't do it. Later, after the fight, Orlando Bloom asked him, why didn't you do it? He said, it wasn't the request. It was the way they asked. And I've always remembered that. It's the way that you ask. It's the way that you...
Yeah.
You can have two people saying the same thing, but the inflection, the nonverbal body language, etc., you'll get two different responses. Now, you've probably seen that in a meeting. Two people say the same thing. With one person, that's a great idea, and the other person gets sloughed off.
Yeah, and it can get received differently based on how it's sent.
Yes.
Also, well, it can also get sent the same way and received differently. But so I actually took a class at work that was building my EQ on it was called Crucial Conversations. And it was about like these kinds of conversations, whenever you have anything with high stakes, opposing opinions, mm-hmm. And strong emotions, you're in a crucial conversation. And the way you, and it's all about how, like we were saying, it's important how you handle the conversation, not so much what you say, but how you say it, because that delivery changes the complete way that someone looks at what you're trying to say.
Exactly. And in today's world, with more transparency, with the only limiting factor being time zones, you're doing business with a diverse range of people from different countries and different cultures. I mean, for example, I have almost 7 million frequent flyer miles. I've traveled quite a bit.
No way.
And I've done...
That's pretty cool.
I've done, you know, a lot of business both in Europe and Asia, and I had an international trip once a month for years. I mean, as an example, on a swing through Asia, when you're going to... You go to Japan, and you go to Korea, and you go to China. Three different cultures, three different ways of
doing three business. Ways of communicating.
You have to understand that these are different customs and cultures, and you have to respect that, and you have to suit your behavior and your communication that so that it is in sync with them. Now, why do you have to do that? They're the customer. I'm selling to them. They don't have to subscribe to me or have to come to my way of thinking, my way of doing business. So you need to understand that.
Yeah, I have a question relating to that. How do you know the balance between, you know, like you're saying, adjusting yourself to the culture, to the people around you, to communicate better with them, and versus, you know, staying true to yourself and confident in yourself and not, you know, changing just because you're around different people, but you still need to, right? So you have to be true to yourself, but still know how to communicate and in a sense change a little bit depending on the situation, right? But how do you know the balance?
That's a good question. And you know, the behavior thing is it comes more from a protocol communication standpoint. I mean, in some countries and some cultures, you know, a direct question, you know, calling somebody by, you know, the first name or a different title is one thing, but in other countries and other cultures, you know, you cannot ask that direct question.
Or even how you greet them, probably.
Exactly. And by the same token, you have to be aware of the hierarchy, and it's much more, there's a different hierarchy and a different protocol in different countries.
So is that a place where positional authority is better, or is it a balance? Like, does it skew the balance a little bit there because when they have higher positional authority, it changes how you communicate, or is it still their personal authority trumps everything?
It's equally both, because when you're, it depends on what you're doing, but if you're selling something that is going to be a contract that's going to be $4, 5, 6, 8, 10 million, they want to see someone that's in a good position. And I was one of the officers of the company. So, and I had a title, so they couldn't send a project manager in. Okay. So you had to have that position. By the same token,
yeah,
if they didn't respect you, okay, they weren't going to do business with you either. So first of all, you have to have a good position, but you also have to go in and conduct yourself in a respectful and professional manner. So if those two match up, your chances are increased quite a bit.
Well, this has been awesome talking to you, Fred, about your book, It Starts With You, Turn Your Goals Into Success. Thanks for joining us this week.
Thank you very much for having me. I've enjoyed the conversation. I look forward to listening to the podcast, and I hope your listeners enjoyed as well and buy the book.
How can people find the book online or find you or more about you or contact you?
Darwin said, it's not the strong that survive, it's those who adapt. I learned early on that you have to use social media to
sell
books and to help promote what this book is about and how it can help people's lives. So I've embraced social media. I'm only a keystroke away. And my site is itstartswithyou.net. It's the title.
Who would have guessed?
.net. It starts with you.net. I have blogs on there. I have information about the book. You can download a couple chapters and read them. There are links to reviews. I have some media, some videos, and just a plethora of information that will point people in the right direction.
Wow.
Very cool.
And you can get the digital version as well, right?
Yeah, I have it in ebook.
There's a Kindle out.
Paperback.
Yes. I got the Kindle version.
And hardcover. And it's going to be available in Japanese in Japan later this year.
Oh, cool. If I had new Japanese, I could buy that version too. Hey, well, if you want to hear an episode like this, we do it every week. Just tap subscribe and you won't miss any action. And if you want to get your book considered that you've read and you really like and is in your, changed your business and your life, or you wrote a book like Fred here, just go to our survey at motivationminute.com and enter the details there. We'd love to feature the book you want to see featured. So thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week.